States, it seems, a long-term bipartisan budget deal. CNN's Suzanne Malveaux is there with the latest for us. Suzanne?
Hey, good morning, Erica. Well, it was actually going on 9 hours, this government shutdown, much of it happening when many Americans were sleeping. And we just saw that Trump tweet about 8:40 in the morning saying that he indeed did sign this bill. And he was good for the military. He also said it meant jobs, jobs, jobs. This was a couple hours after House Speaker Paul Ryan's office actually sent over that bill after it was approved. So there was some confusion this morning about where federal workers needed to be. But now that has been resolved. But Erica, it comes after a night and an early morning drama that happened both on the House and the Senate side that we got a chance to see to make this thing happen. On the House side, it was the House Democrats who slow walked their support for this bill. This was something that needed Democratic support, and you saw the faces of Republicans as the Democrats waited to the very last minute. They were sweating it out whether or not they would get that support. They did. This was something that was somewhat of a strategy by a Nancy Pelosi, Democratic leader, to make sure they could get maximum leverage here, or at least make their colleagues feel uncomfortable. Earlier in the evening, it was drama on the Senate side. This was a lone Republican from Kentucky, Rand Paul, who refused to go along with his fellow senators. They needed 100 unanimous votes to make sure that they could move the vote up just a little bit earlier to go ahead and meet that midnight deadline when the funding ran out. He refused to do so. In fact, he was on the Senate floor many different times making multiple speeches, essentially saying that this was a bill that was way too big, way too expensive, and chastising his own party for being hypocritical. Take a listen.
If you were against President Obama's deficits, you're for the Republican deficits. Isn't that the very definition of hypocrisy?
There is a lot that's at stake here. This is a game-changing bill. This is $400 billion, close to it, a two-year deal, but really changes the way that the government is being funded now. It is a two-year plan. It includes $165 billion for defense, $131 billion for non-defense, $90 billion for disaster relief, as well as raising the debt ceiling through the midterm elections. Also provides $20 billion in infrastructure investment, about $6 billion for drug abuse programs, and a 10-year reauthorization of the CHIP program. So these are things that both Democrats and Republicans really wanted and supported. But the big outstanding question, Erica, essentially is what happens to the Dreamers? Is there a DACA deal to be had here? That still has to be sorted out through Congress and get to the president's desk. Erica.
And that is the next step. Suzanne, thank you. Moving now to the White House and the fallout from the downfall of a close, trusted aide. Officials won't say for the record who knew what, when, about abuse allegations against the now former staff secretary, Rob Porter. Porter's second ex-wife, however, is speaking out. Last night, Jennifer Willoughby telling Anderson Cooper about the incident that prompted her to seek a protective order just months into their marriage.
He came to the apartment where I was staying and refused to leave. And I did ultimately leave, and I closed the door and locked it behind him. He returned a moment later and punched in the glass.
CNN's Abby Phillip is at the White House with more this morning. Abby?
Well, good morning, Erica. This story continues to be a lodestone around this White House's neck at this point. We are learning overnight that President Trump has been upset with the way that this has been handled in the public. He's been upset with several aides, including John Kelly and Hope Hicks, who we know was involved in the drafting of some of the problematic statements released by the White House earlier this week. But we've also learned that John Kelly's job is not likely to be on the line as a result of this, in part because there's really no one to replace him. On the other hand, Kelly is doing some damage control within the White House. He sent out a note to staff last night talking about domestic violence and saying that there is no tolerance for that in the White House. In addition to all of that, we've learned that there are other White House officials who may have been aware about these domestic violence allegations, including White House counsel Don McGahn, whose sources tell us was told earlier in the fall about these problems. problems with Rob Porter getting his security clearance. Apparently, Porter told McGahn that the FBI brought these domestic violence allegations up in his FBI interview as a part of his clearance process. Now, Jennifer Willoughby, the second ex-wife, on television talking more about this publicly. And here's what she had to say about the interactions that she's had with. Since their marriage ended.
Another thing that he wanted me to say was that I had taken some liberties with this therapeutic post, which it was for me, that I had taken liberties with that therapeutic post. And when I thought about it, I didn't. The things that I said were factual statements. He was asking me to downplay it, and he was asking me to emphasize more the relationship that he and I have now, as opposed to what I experienced in our marriage.
So Willoughby says that her interactions with Porter continued up until even this week when all of this was exploding out into the public sphere. She also expressed some concern for Hope Hicks, again, the White House communications director who is in a romantic relationship with Rob Porter. Erica.
Abby Phillip for us at the White House with the latest. Abby, thank you. Joining me now to discuss, CNN political analyst Alex Burns and Josh Dossi and CNN contributor Selena Zito. And I just want to, I'm glad you're all sitting here because I'm going to need you to sit for a moment. I just want to tick through a list of some of the things that have happened since the last government shutdown 3 weeks ago. I'm going to keep the list scrolling because these are, again, just the highlights. So we've had the back and forth on the president sitting down with Mueller and Mr. Trump's attempts to fire Mueller. FBI Deputy Director McCabe is out, as is the Nunes memo, the State of the Union, plus those allegations of treasonous un-American Democrats. There's the all-time high for the stock market, two major plunges in under a week, a White House staff secretary who's out amid allegations of domestic violence, and those two government shutdowns. So is all this happening, one of the things that is not happening is a real discussion on immigration. We haven't tackled DACA or immigration. Does a budget, Joss, give immigration any more momentum? The president said negotiations are going to happen. I don't think we've heard that assurance from Paul Ryan yet.
No, I don't think we have either. And you have a March 5th deadline. Democrats last time said they wanted a shutdown for a DACA deal in the next continuing resolution, in the next budget deal. That obviously didn't happen. And we're still at loggerheads on how to handle immigration. You haven't seen much focus at all from the White House on it. You haven't seen a ton of focus from Capitol Hill on it. And you have a deadline that, you know, is now about 3-4 weeks away for this program that President Trump has said he wanted to keep, but he wants all sorts of concessions in exchange for keeping it. And Democrats do not want to give him those concessions. So I don't think we're much further along on immigration than we were several weeks ago when we shut down the government the last time.
As we look at all of this, we also heard Rand Paul, which we heard more about from Suzanne, calling out his own party about the hypocrisy when it comes to the deficit. Republicans want and need to obviously hold on to both houses in 2018. In fact, the president tweeting this morning that there need to be more Republicans in Washington at this point. Selena, though, is this the type of governing that they can run on for the midterms?
Everything that you've mentioned, right? We're all drinking out of a fire hose every day on news. But I think last night, missing about last night is something that we've missed in the discussion after the election in 2016, because everyone was so sort of focused on the shock that President Trump won. But one of the things that in the exit polling and in interviews that I've done with people is they wanted to see what happened exactly this morning. I think it was this morning when they finally signed the deal and the president signed off on it, is to see more people working across the aisle on issues that impact Americans in their daily lives, and not just in economically, but also with the military and with bigger problems like the opioid crisis. And so that part, that component of governing right now is actually settling and pleasing voters, because this is they're sort of tired of all the right and the left and Republican and the Democrat. They want to see governing. They want to see things get done, and they don't just want to see it from one party.
They may want to see more governing. The president very clear in his tweets, though, that he does not. Tweeting out this morning, without more Republicans in Congress, we were forced to increase spending on things we do not like or want in order to finally, after many years of depletion, take care of our military. Sadly, we needed some Dem votes for passage. Must elect more Republicans in 2018 election. Alex, as we break that down, it's not entirely surprising to see this come from the president. But while Americans may want to see some bipartisan efforts here, the president out of this process clearly doesn't.
No, he doesn't. And I think Celine is absolutely right that was something that we heard through the election from folks who were supporting President Trump, then candidate Trump, was that they thought that he would be able to go to Washington and break down some of the walls between the parties. The fact that the parties did work together on something last night is sort of interesting as a development in Washington and in terms of the balance of power between Congress and the White House. Mm-hmm. But President Trump had very, very little to do with that, as you just said. So I do think going forward, when we look at issues like DACA, when we look at basically everything else that might be on the congressional agenda this year, I think the president kind of has to prove at this point that he is still relevant to legislation, that he can go out there and he can certainly denounce legislation. He can throw a wrench in the works, especially in the House, where Paul Ryan has indicated that he probably won't move immigration legislation that the president opposes. But it's not clear that President Trump at this point, or really at any point, has played a hands-on, constructive role in shaping a policy agenda. I think you do need to look at what happened last night and really everything that's happened, starting with the tax bill, as the product of the Republican leadership and occasionally some Democrats who work across the aisle.
Well, it calls up two questions of leadership there, the Republican leadership, but also the leadership coming from the top, as you point out, Alex. I want to shift now to the discussion about the White House, which we were just talking about with Abby. The big questions here are, again, who knew what when about Rob Porter? And one thing that really just stuck out to me that was glaring is this, you know, a White House source telling our own Jim. There's a reason there was no TikTok at that White House briefing yesterday because, quote, it's too damning. So while there may not be, as we heard from Abby, anyone to replace John Kelly at this point, Josh, how does he survive this? He's the chief of staff. These are the people he's in charge of.
Well, he survives if the president wants him to survive. I mean, our accounting of this is that, you know, starting early last year, 2017, Chief White House Lawyer Don McGahn was made aware that there could be accusations from his ex-wife. Last summer, the FBI gave findings to the White House of some of the accusations made by the ex-wives. By the fall, John Kelly knew about this, wanted to keep Rob Porter in the job, and then around November, Rob Porter's ex-girlfriend came to the White House, to Don McGahn, and said, I want you to be aware of these two ex-wives, which he already knew about. The White House knew about this for months, and they, you know, chose to believe Rob Porter. Even Tuesday, as the first Daily Mail story came out, they put out statements on the record saying that they thought Rob Porter was a man of integrity, that Rob Porter was doing a good job, and they wanted to keep him in the White House. Really only after the blackened eye photos emerged on Wednesday morning did you see a change of tune. And now you have a situation where, you know, the facts that go back 6-7 months, there are a lot of questions. Why didn't anyone take these accusations seriously? Why didn't anyone say this could be a problem? White House folks are saying that internal all those signs, he was professional, he was smart, he was a good colleague, but outside of the office, the women tell a totally different story.
Something we'll continue to dig into ahead throughout this hour. And in our next, we're going to have to leave a discussion there for now. Josh Dossie, Alex Byrne, Celine Zito, thank you. We are counting down at this point to the opening bell. Investors bracing after the Dow plummeted 1,000 points, entering correction territory. Allison Kosick is at the New York Stock Exchange. Allison, how are things looking at this point?
Good morning, Erica. So it looks like in about 20 minutes when the opening bell rings, the Dow could pop into the triple digits, but don't get too comfortable because that volatility that we've been seeing through the market this week is expected to hold on with a vengeance. You look at what happened yesterday, the Dow lost more than 1,000 points, its second biggest point drop ever. And it put the Dow right into correction mode. It put the S&P 500 into correction mode as well. And if you're keeping tabs on your 401k, it means the Dow is in the negative for the year. What's got investors all upset? Inflation and higher interest rates, possibly. So that will continue. That sentiment will continue throughout the day. Erica.
Allison, thank you. We'll check in with you again in a short bit. A stunning moment just a couple of hours ago at the opening ceremony for the Winter Olympics. Just feet apart here in Pyeongchang, CNN correspondent Will Ripley with the latest. It's a picture that took a lot of people by surprise.
Yeah, it's remarkable to look at, Erica. But if you think about it, you have Moon Jae-in, the president of South Korea, sitting next to his most important ally, the United States, represented by the vice president, Mike Pence. But North and South Korea marched together under a unified flag. So the North Korean delegation also needed to be close by. So they were just one row and four seats away from the vice president. From what we're hearing from pool reporters that were there inside the venue, there was no interaction between the vice president and the North Koreans. Of course, the most high-profile delegate from North Korea is Kim Yo-jong. She's the younger sister of Kim Jong-un. She arrived on his private plane here in South Korea. And before the opening ceremonies, they had a moment where they greeted each other. They shook hands. They shook hands again at the event itself. But the most significant event that will be happening is tomorrow in Seoul at the Blue House when President Moon hosts the North Korean delegation for a welcome lunch. These are not formal talks, and so if they were formal talks, then Kim Yong-nam, the leader of the delegation, would be the only person able to speak. But because this is a lunch, Kim Yo-jong can sit down with President Moon, and she can pass along any informal messages from her brother, Kim Jong-un, to the South Korean president. And several diplomatic sources are telling me that there is a good chance that at that lunch, she may invite President Moon to visit North Korea sometime this year. That would be significant. It shows that really Kim Jong-un has sent his sister here to Pyeongchang on a diplomatic mission to try to drive a wedge between the United States and Seoul. Because earlier in the day, Vice President Pence was with Otto Warmbier's father. He was with North Korean defectors. He was talking about maximum pressure on a regime that he called cruel and inhumane and urging South Korea to disengage after the Olympics and join the U.S. in this pressure campaign. But now you have the North Koreans offering further engagement, which is something that President Moon has indicated he may be willing to do under the right conditions. Erica?
Will Ripley with the latest for us from Pyeongchang. Will, thank you. Joining me now is John Park, who's the director of the Korea Working Group at Harvard Kennedy School. Good to have you with us. I'm just curious, your thoughts on that photo and everything that is coming out at this point, including the luncheon that's ahead.
So much going on. These photos are very dramatic. You wouldn't have imagined these photos even weeks ago. However, we have to look at what's happening below the surface, and it's not even that far below the surface. North Korea is basically continuing with its nuclear stance, this idea that they're not going to give up their nuclear weapons. Just before the opening ceremonies, North Korea had the military parade where they displayed their intercontinental ballistic missiles, the ones that they were testing last year, and new systems as well that we're going to be monitoring very closely. But the pictures here are ones of hope when you look at them themselves, this idea that potentially there could be something in the offing in terms of these meetings blossoming into something bigger. But the reality is you have the U.S. pressure on South Korea to basically adhere to maximum pressure, and you have these enticements and these different openings with North Korea. How President Moon balances these two, that's the big question right now.
And the pressure really is on President Moon at this point in terms of the balancing. How much of this do you believe is truly an effort on the part of North Korea? How much of it is perhaps a bit of a display?
I think if you view it from the North Korean perspective of a it is important for them to get closer to South Korea. The thought that by doing that, they can create some distance between South Korea and the United States. South Korea is in a position where they're trying to avert escalation of tensions and possibly war. And I think from the North Korean calculus, that makes the South Korean and the North Korean interests align. But with respect to the North Korea overall, we have to remember the momentum of last year. It seems somewhat distant now, but 2017 was a roller coaster with all of these different types of testing of nuclear and ballistic missile capabilities. And what we're going to see, and we saw Kim Jong-un say this in the New Year's statement, his address, that North Korea, beginning this year, will mass produce nuclear weapons. So there's a lot in store in terms of more rough ride, I should say, in terms of after the Winter Olympics here.
And that's the big key, is what happens after the Olympics. Where does this bring us?
Well, to get to the Winter Olympics and to get the North Korean delegation here, the United States and South Korea decided to postpone their military exercises, an annual joint military exercise. So the fact that they're going to resume the military exercise after the Winter Olympics will be the big litmus test, the first one we'll encounter. We're also anticipating North Korea continuing with the development of their nuclear capabilities. So with the steps ahead in terms of after the closing ceremonies of the Winter Olympics and the Paralympics, this pause that we've seen, we're going to see if it's durable or not. But right now, the expectations
are low. Meantime, we'll have another couple of weeks of pictures coming out of Pyeongchang that will most likely give a number of people pause, images that they haven't seen for some time. John Park, appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bracing for more turmoil, we are just moments away now from the opening bell. Will stocks rebound after another 1,000-point plunge? Less than a minute now until the opening bell, and investors are bracing after Thursday's plunge. Joining me, Christine Romans, chief business correspondent, CNN correspondent Allison Kosick, and Art Hogan, chief market strategist at B. Riley FBR and Wunderlich Securities. Christine, as we look at this, we have just gone through the worst week in a decade.
Yeah.
Why?
Since 2008, and think how terrible 2008 was, the worst week in a decade for stocks, a correction, the first correction in a couple of years for stocks, because there's a new reality setting in that artificially low interest rates are gone, and interest rates are going to start to rise, in part because the economy is so strong. There is a fear of inflation for the first time in a long time, and the Fed is raising interest rates. Ironically, you now have trillion-dollar deficits that you have to raise money for. The bond market is telling us that these deficits are something that are going to mean higher interest rates are necessary. So that's how that sort of feeds in on itself. So you've got a tax cut plan that adds to higher deficits, this new spending bill that adds to deficits, and a strong economy already. And so you've got bonds moving up. And the stock market here looks like it's bouncing a little bit, but it's really hard to tell how this is going to hold out here today.
Bouncing a little bit, Allison, you're there on the floor. We know futures were up this morning. What is the mood like there? I mean, how much concern are you seeing among traders?
You know what, the mood here is good, not only because it's Friday, but because, yes, you're seeing a lot of green on the screen. The big worry was when we saw that huge drop on the Dow yesterday, more than 1,000 points lower, there were big worries about where investors would start the day. So, yeah, we're watching the Dow move higher, up 244 points. But don't get too comfortable, because volatility is going to be holding on with a vengeance. I mean, we've seen that happen all week. It's still expected today. Traders here around me, that is the expectation because of the uncertainty about inflation, and then, of course, the uncertainty about what the Fed is going to do about interest rates. But if you look at what the market has been through all week, especially yesterday, that more than 1,000-point drop in the Dow, that put the Dow in correction mode. The S&P 500 in correction mode as well. What's a correction? It's a 10% drop from a recent high. Now, the hope is that these levels can sort of stay and now move up. But sounder minds know that may not be the case, since volatility really is the only certainty here these days, Erica.
Volatility is the only certainty. Art, you said that earlier in the week. Volatility has returned to the market, which we've seen. If you have your crystal ball out this morning, Art, the big question for a lot of people, of course, is how long does this volatility stay with us?
Well, that's a great question, and typically these things take a while to wash out, and I think this will be true here. Remember, Friday's going to be tricky. This is a great opening, seeing a nice bounce, especially with the magnitude of the flush out we saw in the last half hour of yesterday. But we get margin calls somewhere between 11 o'clock and 2 o'clock. That tends to get some action to the sell side. Fridays tend to be that day where people don't want to go into the weekend with a long position. And as we look at this, I think we've got to test that 200-day moving average before we have a significant bounce. So yesterday we broke the 100-day moving average and flirted with the 200-day. We've tested it in the futures market. So whether that happens today or sometime next week, I think that'll signal the bottom. I think we've done a nice job of getting a lot of that short vol trade out of the way, and the volumes there yesterday were significant. The overall volumes have been significant for the entirety of this week. We may have a little more work to do the downside, but we're getting close.
Getting close. Christine, I heard you say earlier this morning on air that you cut deficits when the economy is good. Mm-hmm. As you just laid out, and as we know with the bill that the president just signed in terms of the budget, that's not what's happening. So how concerning is that as we throw that into the mix?
I mean, it's really interesting, because we heard from the GOP for years they were so against the deficit spending of the Obama administration, so against those trillion-dollar deficits, and now we have a $1.1 trillion deficit here for 2019, and that we thought maybe that would be 2020 or 2021, but 2019 already here. So that's an ironic position to be in with the party in charge who are the deficit hawks. I will say, though, what you hear from the White House, you hear from others, they say that we are going to have growth just explode because of the tax cuts. And the growth is going to eat away at those deficits. So that's what they're hoping for. But right now you've got interest rates rising, and as interest rates rise, it becomes more expensive to service your debt or to issue new debt. You know, it's something important to watch.
And remind me too, in terms of that talking point. I mean, that's all well and good, and we may in fact see growth in that way. But is there a particular timeline attached to that?
Look, it's very hard to tell what's going to happen in the economy in the near term. This is an expansion that, and Art can correct me on this, but it's, you know, 9 years old at this point. This is a bull market that's 9 years old for sure. So if you've got an overheating economy and a Fed that's raising interest rates, you know, now you're talking about next year or the year after recession. You know, so we don't know what's going to happen with the economy in the very, very near term. We do know it is strong today. It is strong today. The job market is very good today. Wages are rising today. You could see the unemployment rate go below 4% by the summer, many economists are telling me. That's all good. That's why the economy is heating up, and that's why interest rates are rising.
And when we look at interest rates rising, how much of that, this is what oftentimes can really bring it home for Main Street, Art. How much of that do you think is a concern at this point?
Well, that's a concern in three ways, and I think that's what started this particular correction. I think interest rates cut three ways, right? So it costs more for you and I to borrow and spend money. So that slows down our economic activity. It costs more for the government to run their business, and that slows down their activity in corporate America. It costs them more money. But the other way that it cuts is at some point in time, you look at interest rates and say, well, if I can get 3 or 3.5% for 10 years, I'm going to take my money out of the stock market and put it into the bond market. I don't think we're anywhere close to what that level would be, but there's a higher price that you have to pay, or you need to return more as a stock in a higher interest rate environment, and that's where things get difficult. So for 7 years, with a 2% yield on the U.S. 10-year, you could run an 18 or 19 multiple in the S&P 500. At 3 and 3.5, you probably have to be 16.5 or 17 times, and oddly enough, that's what the market's recalibrating right now.
You know, the higher interest rates are here, Erica. I mean, you look at the 30-year fixed rate mortgage, that's already 4.32%. That's the highest in a couple of years. Mm-hmm. So interest rates are rising in the market, and you've got mortgage rates that are rising as well. So people who are home buyers are noticing this right now, that these rates are going higher. I will say, though, these are still historically low interest rates. They're not the super duper low, artificial low interest rates that we've seen over the past years, but they are still pretty low. The post-war average for a mortgage rate is something like 6.5%. So it's still much better than that,
right?
But it's something people are starting to notice.
All right. Christine, Art, Allison, thank you all. Minutes ago, President Trump saying negotiations on DACA are starting now, with less than a month left until the deadline. How confident are Democrats the White House is in fact ready to make a deal?
And Luis has been our leader on that. This question of a tactic, a shutdown as a tactic, is another question. But we've got to do it, and it's really on Paul Ryan, because he could put that bill out there, and he won't. And by the way, Paul Ryan made it clear when he became Speaker that he wanted to give the House an opportunity to work its will, and that he wasn't going to be wedging unrelated things together. So frankly, I understand where Luis is coming from, mm-hmm. but the target really is Paul Ryan.
So if the target is Paul Ryan, I know that earlier this week, you and Representative Upton sent a letter on behalf of the Problem Solvers Caucus asking Speaker Ryan to commit to open negotiation here. Have you heard anything from the Speaker or from his office?
Well, we haven't directly in response.